the press conference ended, and I walked into the locker room where another member of our staff, Chris Melvin, was, and he said, as he always does, you know, "Hey, how was coach?" And I paused and I thought, not sure how to succinctly describe it. And he goes, "What do you mean?" I'm like, "I think you'll see it soon enough." And as it turns out, often enough.
They are who we thought they were.
Thanks, coach.
Monday Night Football, all the lights are out, the roof is open, everybody's going crazy. Because Matt Leinart was only making his second start, he was still in that, you know, huge superstar of LA kind of deal. So, you know, he had as his guest Ashton Kutcher and Demi Moore were at the game on the sideline before the game and then watching the game in the box. Charles Barkley showed up and he ended up making an appearance in the booth. There was a vibe to it.
They may have the best rookie quarterback of this year's crop in Leinart, and they may have the best stadium in the NFL. This place is spectacular.
It was kind of an electricity, and it was, you got the feeling too, it's like the Cardinals have been so disappointing. This was a pivotal game. They needed to win this game, and if they did, it kind of showed you, okay, they could bounce back and have a decent season.
We struggled out of the gate. We really felt like we had a lot of games slip away from us, and we were really frustrated, and everybody was talking about how this was going to be a non-competitive Monday Night Football game, and we took that to heart.
It was a high-pressure game for us. You know, we were expecting to go out there and have the opportunity to get a win.
Leinart looking, delivering, scoring!
There's a reason Denny Green said, "Who takes the third game of the preseason like it's blank?" The Cardinals played well in the third game of the preseason in Chicago. The first three quarters, they outplayed the Bears.
Anytime you play the third preseason game, that's like the practice. That's like the real dry run, if you will, before the regular season starts. And so we went up to Soldier Field and we smacked them around pretty good.
When you already played a team in the preseason, especially that late in the preseason, you can find what's fake and what's real. We knew that late inside the preseason that, honestly, I, to this day, still think that we had the better overall team.
The Cardinals with the takeaway.
The Arizona Cardinals want to win. The Arizona Cardinals want to bring a championship to the citizens of Arizona.
He was the type of guy that he was very confident. He was confident in himself. He was confident in his ability.
It's the first victory for the new Cardinals.
He talked a lot about things that he had accomplished. He was a guy that didn't really feel like he needed to deal with a lot of the small stuff, if you will.
Every day was an adventure. You never knew what you were going to get. I always felt like sometimes I needed a Denny Green interpreter.
This is going to be a chance for me to prove myself. You prove yourself. You prove yourself. You'll be here a long time. I prove myself. I'll be here a long time.
What does he mean when he talks about, you know, Harrisburg math? And the Green family pie, and you know how you divvy up reps, and how you—it was, you know, you'd ask him a question, and you know he answered my friend Darren Urban one time. Well, that's awful philosophical for a Wednesday, you know. And so Wednesdays became philosophical questions, and you'd ask him a question, and the answer, quite often, had nothing to do with the question.
Hey, any questions,
Denny's? Message the team was, hey, block out all the noise. Don't forget, it wasn't that long ago. We were in Chicago in week three of the preseason, and you know we stood toe to toe.
You know, we did have success against them in the preseason. I got a chance to play against them in the preseason, which was good, and they did have all their starters in when we were playing most of them, you know, and so that's refreshing, I guess.
We got Lovie Smith on our conference call that week, and you know, Denny had kind of talked about, you know, hey, we played them in a preseason, we played pretty well. We can play with this team, even though at this time the Cardinals were 1-4 and the Bears were undefeated. Lovie Smith was asked about it.
This is the first time we would have played them, as I see it. The preseason games are important. They're glorified practices to me.
And I think that got under Denny's skin a little bit.
I think that's important to know and to understand that Denny was probably a little disappointed when Coach Smith said, yeah, that preseason game didn't mean as much to us as it seemingly did to you.
This is a big game. It's a Monday night game. If we're lucky, the roof will be open. I think it'll be enough excitement to light the whole valley up.
Quick toss, Brian Johnson made a man miss. Brian Johnson to the end zone. Arizona, touchdown.
I'm thinking to myself in the press box, oh my God, they might have found their quarterback of the future, finally.
Anquan Boldin, touchdown, Arizona.
The Cardinals dominated them in the first half. I mean, dominate. Matt Leinart was so sharp, and you could tell the Cardinals had a game plan that put the Bears on their heels, and they were moving the ball. And the Bears, Rex Grossman was turning the ball over all the time. And I thought, you know, they're going to win this game.
Intercepted! What is going on tonight?
Chicago was the hottest team in the NFL at that time. And we just took them to the back alley, man, and we beat them up. You know what I'm saying? We really, literally beat them up that whole game. And we exposed them for who they were.
I can't remember being that dominant on the defensive side to where they really didn't score any points offensively and have, I believe it was 6 turnovers. We just felt like we knew these guys. We played them in the preseason, we studied them then. They didn't really switch up much of what they'd done heading into that game. So we felt like we had a pulse on what they were trying to do, and we went out there with a ton of confidence.
It was going really, really well for us. Until it wasn't, and...
Second half of the 15, he's hit from behind. Mark Anderson, the hit, the scoop, and score for Mike Brown. The Bears get back in it.
I think Denny Green went to offensive coordinator Keith Rowan and said, back off, run the ball, drain the clock. And that's what they did. Brian Urlacher finished with like 119 tackles in that game. He hit Edgerrin James so often, it was unbelievable. I've never seen one player hit another player so often in a game. And even though the Cardinals got conservative and stunk, the Bears still had to have 4 things go exactly right for them to win that game.
Devin Hester, all the way! Touchdown, Chicago Bears!
Absolutely incredible. They've scored no points on their own offense.
An unbelievable comeback by the Bears here in Arizona.
It's all on you. This is what you do.
It's third down. Liner throws complete for the first down to Ayam Badejo. Already in field goal range. Liner throws for Boldin, who caught it.
Matt Leinart marches us down the field and puts us in position for, I want to say, a 40-ish yard field goal. And
the field goal is leaking. It's no good.
We don't make it. Had we made it, history would judge the next half hour, 45 minutes much differently than it does now.
You know, Rack was usually money. I think he went to the Pro Bowl that year. I think he was so good up until that point. It just felt like everything was against us, and I can't even tell you what that locker room felt like afterwards. It was one of the more bizarre locker rooms that I had ever seen.
One of the biggest disappointments of my career is I stayed in the press box because I was on deadline.
I was literally in the first row right in front of the podium. And I remember thinking to myself as he started, I was bracing myself because I'm thinking, here's a guy who's going to give us 2-word answers. He's going to be super ticked off. And he wasn't.
It began pretty unremarkably, and it was all going pretty much pro forma. Nothing too much out of the ordinary.
I don't think I've ever been associated with a loss where it was kind of clear that the offense couldn't score a touchdown.
People started asking questions about hard stuff, and he answered like it was any other game.
I think anybody watching this game is surprised by the ending, and you never should be surprised in a game of football. All the way right down to the last 40 seconds.
And then the question came, and it was a freelance writer, and he was writing for one of the Chicago papers.
In this particular case, I reached out to the Chicago Sun-Times. I had made some contacts with them in the past, worked for them in the past. So I worked that night for the Sun-Times, augmenting their coverage on site.
It had to do with Rex Grossman and the Cardinals forced, I think, 6 takeaways.
I was not a Cardinals beat writer, so I'm not here every day for practice or for games. So I didn't know Dennis's personality or how he would respond. I thought the Cardinals defense played extremely well that night, and that was going to be the focus of my sidebar, and that was the essence of the question.
Coach, 4 picks against Grossman and 2 fumbles. What did you see about the Bears? We shut them down that way.
No, the Bears are what we thought they were. They're what we thought they were.
The emotion sort of keeps escalating.
We played them in preseason. Who the hell takes a 3rd game in a preseason like it's bullshit? Bullshit.
But it's natural under the circumstances. It's certainly not beyond reason.
We played him in the 3rd game. Everybody played 3 quarters.
And then he's getting more excited and perhaps more agitated.
The Bears are who we thought they were. And that's why we took the damn field.
I kind of like put my head down. I'm like, oh God, this is going to be a big deal.
Now, if you want to crown them, then crown their ass. But they are who we thought they were. And we let them off the hook.
When he pauses, we better shut this down. We better not let another question keep this thing going.
Thanks, Coach. Matt Leinart will be the only other person in this room. Probably
as I think back, we probably weren't going to get another question because as you look around the room, there were a lot of jaws on the floor and people were a little like, okay. So as you read the room, I thought it would be appropriate, in hindsight, perhaps not, to just, hey, nothing to see here.
We knew it was an instant classic, that's for sure.
Who the hell takes a 3rd game in a preseason like it's bullshit, bullshit?
The rare use of bullshit, bullshit, back-to-back was just, you don't see that in a press conference very often.
We understood his frustration, because we all were frustrated at that moment. Because we put so much work into that week, knowing leading up to that game, because we knew we had a chance to win.
And we let him off the hook.
I was on the other side of that door, and all I had the knowledge of was our producer, Jim Almohandro, in my ear saying, oh boy, Coach just knocked over the podium. He's bleeping bleep, and here he comes.
I remember getting in the shower, getting in my car, going home. I didn't even know about the rant until the next day. I was at home, I'd eaten breakfast, a little something, woke up before I got to the facility, and of course, they were running it on nonstop loop.
Can the Cardinals recover from a loss like that?
Well, I think they can. I'm serious. I think they can. Are who we think we are. You just crown them.
I know you can do it, Jimmy. Crown them.
It was all over. It was beautiful.
My jaw just dropped. Like, I couldn't believe what I was seeing. And
I said to my wife on the drive home, what the hell did he mean by that? You know, I know exactly that we, you know, what it meant to say we let him off the hook.
They are who we thought they were, and we let him off the hook.
They're who we thought they were. I had to really ponder on that one for a while.
It wasn't a rant. We knew 100% what he was talking about.
He was very, very frustrated by it, and I think any coach worth his salt would have been as frustrated about it. And he did it in a special way that only Dennis Green could do it.
His doctor told him the best thing that he ever did was release that frustration. It was a good stress reliever to go ahead and pound the podium and go on that epic rant. To keep that stress inside would have been unhealthy, according to Denny. So he did it, he always maintained, in the best interest of his health, per doctor's orders.
And I think anybody who was at that press conference would have been afraid to ask him the next day. And so the way I approached it with Coach Green was, hey, let's get ready for the next game. You know, we're moving on, but heck, if I'd have brought that up, I'd have probably feared for my life in there.
So we met again Wednesday, and the first thing he said in the team meeting, he said, I wish I could lock the defense in the room with the offense and let you guys go at it. He was so upset at the offense. And I think that was one of the few times that he had taken a side.
He never really seemed like he would have done it much differently. Ultimately, it became a beer commercial, and he leaned into it.
Well, who do you think they were?
They are who we thought they were.
Okay.
I don't think he really understood how big of a moment that was. And then once he processed it later on, he kind of was like, wow, I didn't realize it would be that big, but here we are. I might as well own it now. And if I can make a few dollars off of it, why not?
It wasn't funny after the loss, but after a few years being removed and like seeing this commercial pop up and it's, you know, the same deal. And it's like, man, this is hilarious. You know, you can like laugh and joke with guys about it.
From the beginning to the end to the mic slap, it was to Mark Dalton coming in and breaking it up. It was a thing of beauty.
And if he wanna crown him, then crown their ass. But they were who we thought they were. And we let them off the hook.
You know, I mean, of course, you know, everybody's got their way of doing it. But I just, when I think about that, when I close my eyes and I think about it, I always think of Mark Dalton. Because Mark was the one that had to say, thank you, Denny.
Sadly, Denny passed away in 2016, and a number of us went to San Diego to his funeral service. And the program of the funeral service was really well done, and like many, it had his picture on the front and the program and the songs and the scripture readings. But on the back page of the program, it had famous Denny Green quotations. And I think there were 8 to 10, but the very first one in the program at his funeral was, they are who we thought they were.